So welcome. It's a great honor for me to be with you today to lead in the celebration of a legendary figure, our beloved late colleague, Professor Derrick Bell. As most of you know, each year the Annual Survey of American Law dedicates its forthcoming issue to a person who has made a towering contribution to the law. And in the past, as you can see from the list, the recipients have included Supreme Court justices, famous judges, professors, two people sitting here, President Sexton and Professor Dorsen. And Derrick is very much fits with this august group. The students make the selection. They picked Derrick a year ago. He was very touched to accept the honor. And it's poignant and sad that he can't be here with us today to speak at this event, but he's here with us, I'm sure, in more meaningful ways. The students made the decision they couldn't have done a better job. The two qualities that I think best exemplify Derrick's life and that weave in and out of everything he did professionally our courage and integrity. Derrick graduated from the University of Pittsburgh Law School in 1957 and went on to work with the Civil Rights Division of the U.S. Department of Justice. He was at the time the only African American among hundreds of lawyers. He wasn't there too long. He left after just 2 years when the government asked him to resign his membership in the NAACP. Instead, Derrick resigned his position in the U.S. Department of Justice and went on to become the first assistant counsel at the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, working under Thurgood Marshall, supervising hundreds of school desegregation cases. I learned a lot about this period, the litigation, and Derrick's role, actually from Justice Marshall himself, from whom I clerked in 1984-85. And like Derrick, Justice Marshall was a great storyteller. And I got a sense of what it was like to be a lawyer in the South, what the pressures were like, what the stakes were like, and what the enormous excitement about the possibility the world would end up being different. In the next phase of his career, Derrick challenged law schools across the country to embrace diversity in their hiring practices. Boldly willing to leave the positions that he held as a professor at Harvard Law School, where he was the first tenured African-American professor, and then at the University of Oregon Law School, where he was the first African-American dean. His willingness to stand up to a principle that he believed in is characteristic of his deep commitment to causes. I know that he was excited to set an inspiring example to his students, but the reward was, as he said, in the resulting spiritual soul-satisfying dividends, and Derrick earned lots and lots of those dividends. We're really fortunate that Derrick joined our community, our faculty, in 1990, and was our colleague for more than 20 wonderful years. He was a terrific colleague and a terrific mentor. I think it's fair to say, in the presence of a number of faculty colleagues, that I don't think there's anyone in this building who is more dedicated to their students than Derrick was, even though I'm very proud of the dedication that our faculty show to their students. He was devoted to them substantively. He taught every year a constitutional law course that was legendary. And it was incredibly complicated, involved TAs and TAs, TAs, and research assistants and whatever, and they all got together in many drafts. I'm sure you'll hear a lot more about this. He would describe this to me. It was way too complicated for me to understand, but I got the sense of the thought that had gone into the design of the course. Derrick also was very precise, and the other thing I would get from him once every year was a very complicated spreadsheet. I mean, it wasn't in Excel. I don't think Derrick did Excel, but it was, he excelled, but he didn't do the program. but it was a spreadsheet nonetheless, and it showed me what the cost was going to be for the dinners with various options. Like, what would happen if you invited 6 students per evening as opposed to 8? And if they didn't order appetizers, what would this look like? And obviously decided not to micromanage how Derrick decided to have these dinners with the students, but it was clear from both his discussions and the discussions of the students that this was a hugely significant part of the teaching that went on. And it's hard. You know, it'd be wonderful if I could tell you that all of our faculty members do this. It doesn't happen all that frequently. Derrick was also a courageous scholar, and he helped launch the critical race theory movement in the mid-70s with his famous casebook, Race, Racism, and American Law, that has dominated the field ever since its publication. While on our law school faculty, he published many books, including Silent Covenant, Brown versus Board of Education, The Unfulfilled Hopes for Racial Reform in 2004, Afro-Atlantica Legacies in 1998, Constitutional Conflicts in 1997, Confronting Authority, Reflections of an Ardent Protester in 1996. I also know a fair amount about these books because Derrick, I said this last year for the Derrick Bell Lecture, was in many ways very conservative and old-fashioned, and I think a lot of people don't appreciate that. He would come and see me every year. He'd make an appointment and come and bring me the book that he had published, and bring me a memo about the courses he was teaching. And it was great. And one year, I thanked him after our conversation. It was always a great conversation. And I said, Derrick, this is great, and I love these meetings, but you know, why do you feel a need to do this? And he says, well, that's what one does with deans. That's how Irwin Griswold did it. No one ever compared me to Irwin Griswold. And even if Irwin Griswold actually did this, no one else on our faculty got the message. So this wasn't a usual occurrence, and it was Derrick who did it. The last time I saw Derrick was about 2 weeks before his death. He was in a wheelchair, and he was here. He was coming with Janet. They were sort of walking along the sidewalk, and he was coming to teach his seminar. And he was obviously not in good physical shape. And he told me that it was his goal was to finish that seminar, and he hoped he could do it. And in the end, he couldn't quite do it, although he did, because the seminar actually continued both in the fall and, of course, continued in the spring as well, because Professor Tony Thompson was inspired and stepped into, I mean, it's didn't quite step into Derrick's shoes, but he kept the course going, and it meant a great deal to Tony, who unfortunately has some health issues in his family and couldn't be here with us and apologizes profusely. I'm really pleased that Derrick's wife, Janet Duard Bell, is here. Janet is as dedicated a member of the law school community as was Derrick, and also a special welcome to Derrick's son, Derrick Bell III. Derrick and Janet brought to the law school very prominent scholars every year for the annual Bell Lecture to discuss contemporary and hard-hitting issues about race relations in America. This fall, in a kind of a packed house in Tishman Auditorium, we welcome Professor Ian Haney Lopez of the University of California at Berkeley to discuss what he termed reactionary colorblindness and affirmative action. The life of the Bell family at the law school is not just lectures, it's also music. So every year, inspired by Derrick and Janet's passion for music, we've had the annual Bell Gospel Choir concert that fills this room with song and with powerful sound of courage and conviction, and we recently had it here. So I can't really think of how the students could have done a better job, both when they picked Derrick and when they decided that he would be a posthumous honoree. And so now I want to call up the person who's really responsible for this event and who will be responsible for shepherding the issue that will commemorate this event, and that's Ben Wolford. So Ben is a third-year student. He graduated from Northwestern University. In addition to being the editor-in-chief of the annual Survey of American Law, He serves the law school as a mentor to transfer students. He worked as a summer associate for Sullivan and Cromwell, and through New York Lawyers for the Public Interest, worked as an extern in the West Side SRO Law Project, conducting research on landlord-tenant law. He interned for a judge on the Eastern District of New York, and he will begin working at Sullivan and Cromwell as a litigation associate this fall. Journalists had another great year under Ben's direction. Thank you, Ben, for all you did to make today possible.
Well, I've never been introduced by Dean before, so that was very nice of you. And also, thank you very much, Dean Revesz. The dedication ceremony is a very meaningful part of the annual survey of American law, and so we're very grateful for the support you've shown, not just this year, but throughout all of the years past. Thank you also to everyone in Student Affairs for your help with this event, including Paul O'Grady, David Mora, Susan Anderson, and Tracy Nwafor. And finally, thank you to Lisa Boykin, and of course, to Janet Deward-Bell. I cannot tell you how thankful I am for your support of this event and for your help in pulling everything together, so thank you very much. And one more introductory note. As you arrive today, you may have spoken to members of the Coalition on Law and Representation, also known as COLOR, and the All-ALSA Coalition. These two student organizations here on campus have collaborated to form the Honoring Derrick Bell Committee, which is dedicated to honoring the legacy of Derrick Bell, his critical race scholarship, and his student-centered teaching style. So if you'd like more information on that group and their efforts, we invite you to provide them your contact information on your way out if you haven't already done so. So as Dean Revesz mentioned, every year the Annual Survey of American Law dedicates a volume of its publication to a member of the legal community in honor of their contributions to American law. Traditionally, the role of the editor-in-chief at these events is to summarize a few of those contributions which inspired our board to nominate the dedicatee. But in the case of Professor Bell, his contributions to American law and legal scholarship are both too numerous and too profound to do them any justice in my short time up here. And plus, there are far more qualified people on the stage for that task. So as the only student speaking today, and if my fellow students in the room will permit me to speak a little bit for them, I would like to offer a very brief observation of one of the many ways in which Professor Bell has impacted American law students. As law students, we are constantly made aware of the many differences between theory and practice. Or to put differently, the differences between law school and the real world. Many of us beginning next fall will retreat to law firms or other institutions engaged in the practice of law, and there the riveting policy debates and the scrutiny of the implications of court decisions that became so fundamental to our law school experiences will seem to disappear or at the very least become less prominent. Instead, we will seem to become something other than students with theories and opinions. We will become practitioners with clients, bosses, and cases. And I'm fairly certain that for all of us, this transition will present numerous challenges and that we will quickly find ourselves in a situation where it will appear difficult, if not impossible, to reconcile our beliefs with those of our clients and those of our bosses. In other words, I'm sure we will all face moments early in our careers where it will be difficult to practice what we preach, something that as students seems so easy to do. And perhaps to ease our discomfort in these situations, we will remind ourselves of the differences between theory and practice, law school and the real world. Professor Bell, through both his scholarship and actions, constantly reminded students that this does not have to be the case. Professor Bell spent his entire career as a legal scholar and a practitioner, and at every step of the way was able to stay true to his own theories and convictions. Whenever he faced a conflict between his beliefs and countervailing professional pressures, he never let the former succumb to the latter. To use Professor Bell's own words that were referenced in the most recent Time Magazine's Person of the Year issue, in an interview there that had taken place prior, he said he was, quote, grateful for the opportunity to, in so public a way, practice what I have preached for so long. And so as my fellow students and I begin to cope with the anxiety of transitioning from law school life to the real world, I think that we all, whether knowingly or not, and regardless of whether or not we were lucky enough to know him personally or take a class with Professor Bell, are nonetheless grateful to have Professor Bell's career as a shining example reminding us that we should never forget those debates in our classes or lose our identity as students with ideas. And more importantly, we should never, as he was never, afraid to practice what we preach. So this is one of the many ways in which Professor Bell has impacted American law students, and I'm sure law students all over the world, and one of the reasons why I'm so thankful that the Board of Annual Survey voted overwhelmingly to dedicate our 69th volume to Professor Derrick Bell. So on behalf of the Board of Editors of the New York University Annual Survey of American Law, I am honored to welcome you as we formally dedicate our 69th volume to commemorate the scholarship and legacy of Professor Derrick Bell. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. So we have four speakers now. I'll introduce each one. Our first one really needs no introduction. He already welcomed us in his portrait over there and then in person over here. It's John Sexton, my boss, my predecessor as dean of the law school, as you know now, the president of New York University. John was the dean of the law school for 14 years. During that period, he transformed the law school just as profoundly as he's now transforming the university, literally putting us on the map in sites around the world with what is now known as his bold and visionary global network university that was incubated here at the law school through the Hauser Global Law School program. He's a renowned teacher. He continues to teach very popular undergraduate seminars in New York and in Abu Dhabi. He's a co-author of the leading casebook on civil procedure and is an incredibly significant spokesperson for higher education. It's only fitting that John, among countless other accolades, was, as I indicated earlier, the annual survey's honoree in 2003, and that he is the person who's responsible, having brought Derrick Bell to the law school. Derrick had been John's former Harvard professor, and in 1990, John persuaded Derrick to come and become an NYU professor, and that's how this sort of love of NYU Law School and Derrick got started. So thank you, John, for being here, and thank you for all you did for the law school and do for the university.
Ricky brought a great affliction into my life when he gave an interview to a magazine about 15 years ago and revealed something that I didn't know, which was that colleagues, when they would come to meetings with me, expected a hug when they entered the room and that they would judge when they left the room how well the meeting had gone by whether they got a hug on the way out. and this is called all kinds of game theory principles to mind, and I've inadvertently insulted people by not giving them hugs or by giving them hugs, but it's wonderful to be in this room, and I appreciate the feeling of this place, and I appreciate very much that whatever I did in telling the story of this place and my colleagues and the wonderful people that made up the community here while I was here, that Ricky has surpassed anything that I ever dreamt for the school, and that the place just keeps getting better and better, and you can feel it when you return, and you can see it in the glow of people's faces. It's a privilege to talk about Derrick. It's appropriate that we honor him with the dedication of the annual survey, which is given, of course, for extraordinary eminence in the profession of law. But Derrick was extraordinarily eminent in the profession of law because Derrick was an extraordinarily eminent person. He was, first and foremost, a human being and an extraordinary human being. Anybody that knew him, had the privilege of knowing him, understood first and foremost that it was the deepness of his soul that gave him the deepness of all that he did in life. And the spectacular thing about Derrick was that Derrick manifests that deepness and fundamental spirituality in such an extraordinary way that it was impossible to miss. It's also appropriate that we honor him through the vehicle of the Annual Survey of American Law, because Derrick did love students most. He loved causes. He loved ideas. But he loved students most, and that's again because if you push through his love for students, he loved people most. He was most of all an extraordinary person who cared about people. And the fewer people that someone had caring about him or her, the more Derrick cared about that person. And that gave him his purpose. Now, perhaps uniquely in the room, I mean, there are folks that have known Derrick much longer even than I, but I think that I probably moved in orbit around the magnificent son of Derrick in more ways than anyone else. I first met Derrick in 1976, and as with many things in my life, I met him because of my wife. Lisa despised Harvard Law School. At the end of our first year at Harvard Law School, she announced that it was a racist, sexist place, and that she would not ever set foot on the Harvard Law School campus again. I think in part she married me because I was a good note taker. and she said to me, "You just register me for the courses that you take and take good notes." And she arranged to have her exams taken at the Commander Hotel across the street from the Harvard Law School campus. And she never set foot on the Harvard Law School campus again. She frequently embarrassed me by getting better grades than me. And she graduated cum laude. And very rarely did she insist in this portfolio of courses I was taking both for myself and for her that I take a particular course. She said, "The one course you have to take second year is Derrick Bell's course in Race, Racism, and American Law." And that was how I ended up in the back of Derrick's classroom. I was the oldest person in our class by a considerable margin. At that time, I was 35. And I used to wear flannel shirts. They'd hang out, and I would carry, since I would come home from, come down from our house for the day, because I had to do our classes and then do some work on campus. I'd come with a big, tall thermos of coffee, and I would sit there in the back. Derrick made fun of this years later, because I'd sit there in the back, because I never spoke. I know it's hard for you to believe here, but I never spoke in law school. I only once I was called on by Arthur Miller. It was the only time in 3 years of 3 years of law school that I spoke not at all, and I would sit in the back of Derrick's class, and the way he told it, and Janet will remember this because we would laugh about this over in Volare, he and Janet and Lisa and I, years later, he said, "You know, this bearded guy with this flannel shirt kind of looking like a truck driver sitting in the back row with his mug of coffee, I didn't have any idea whether he was a street person, but the important thing was..." The important thing is he didn't care. You know, I was there. I was obviously taking notes. I had to take notes, right? And he would claim I took notes and was doing law review galleys at the same time. He claimed, and you know, Derrick would never call on anybody in class, and I never volunteered in class, and he was never quite sure I was in class. And then, of course, the way they did it, the exams were anonymous, and the results came out, and I think Lisa got the highest grade in the class. And I wasn't too far behind. But Derrick called her at home and said, you know, you got the highest grade in the class, and I don't remember you being there. And Lisa said, well, she wasn't embarrassed about this. She just said, well, I wasn't ever there. But my husband was taking notes in the class, and really, and what's his name? And he said, oh, well, he got a pretty good grade, too. But I don't remember him being there either. What's he look like? And then she described me. He said, oh, my God. And he said, well, will the two of you come to see me? And she said, no. But I'll send him. I don't go on to the Harvard Law School campus. And that was the first time I met him, just the two of us in his office. And it was the beginning of a love affair. And, you know, Derrick, even the way he teaches, we all know. I mean, he wasn't teaching that way then. There were no charts then or whatever. He was locked in the Harvard system, although it was, you know, he had the capacity that the really, really great teachers have to make you think about something completely differently from the way you thought about it before you began to work with him. Now, look, I start off, you know, as a very, very, you know, kind of a straight, white, 50s Catholic male. So there's a lot Derrick had to teach me. But I think all of his students, no matter whence they came, had that experience, that he was capable of getting you to think in a completely different way. But, you know, the remarkable thing about Derrick was that he and Jewel, the first of his two great loves. And this was something else about the man, that he was blessed with not one, but with two great loves. And both of them models for anybody that's ever been in love. But he and Jewel, even though we were students, took us in as couple friends. We became couple friends of theirs and got to know the boys. I remember when I used to tutor this man. And we went through Jewel's death with him. And then I remember the magnificent Janet and how she arrived in his life. I remember when he first told me about it. One of the indelible memories in our family is your great, great wedding right over on Broadway with that little girl, Katie, running around on that balcony with the wrought iron. Okay, it's an image that I'll never forget because, again, the accepting quality, to let a little girl come, to let her run around, even as the wedding was going on, to not be bothered by the noise. But it was just so typical of the two of them. And Derrick formed, in some ways, I'm not sure I'd be here today if it hadn't been for his pushing me as a scholar. You know, I was a reach. I was an older person. I had been a PhD in religion. I wasn't an orthodox appointment for a great law school like this law school. Bert chaired the personnel committee and struggled to make me credible. But one of the ways in which I was because Derrick wouldn't let me rest on my first piece for the Law Review. So when Bakke came out, and everybody thought the world was ending, Derrick called me in and said, you're going to do something that's important. And he guided me to write a piece for the Harvard Education Review as a lawyer and former teacher that had worked with high school kids that were on their way up about how Bakke wasn't the end of the world, even though he didn't agree with the Powell opinion. He said, you can write a piece that will show how the Powell opinion might be a guide. And sure enough, it's been a guide. Hopefully, will continue to be a guide even after this Supreme Court term. God forbid it not be. But, you know, Derrick helped me build my portfolio. And then I remember I was the Supreme Court editor of the Review. And he came to me and said, so they've asked me to do the foreword. Do you think they'll take this piece? That was Chronicles. Nothing ever like it had been. And I said, well, I think they'll take the piece because that's my issue. And we managed to work Chronicle through that stodgy old process. And he guided me right through my years here. He was one of the ones that encouraged me to take on the responsibility of being a dean. He said, I think there's something you can do. And then, of course, and I'll just close with this because Janet likes me to tell. This is like the Passover Seder. This story has to be told every time I talk about Derrick. And I apologize, about three quarters of you have probably heard this now a dozen times, but the great stories, the Iliad, the Odyssey, and this story of Derrick Bell deserve to be repeated. So then there was the hunger strike, you know, and Derrick is going to, he's not going to eat, is the way I remember it. Tree told it a little bit different at the memorial service, but I think I remember this right. Tree's never been good on the facts. But anyway, there was and I called him up and I said, you know, you're right, but you got the wrong diagnosis here. Walk out on them. Come to NYU. We love you here. And he came down as a visiting faculty member that year, and we had a great year together. And it was the end of the year, and where Babo's is now used to be a restaurant called the Commanders. It was Commanders, I think, was the name of it. And we were having dinner in there, and we over lobster bisque. And he says to me, you know, I've never been happier at a law school. I said, well, that's a pretty low bar. I said, you didn't get along with the dean at Oregon when you were at Oregon. He said, I was the dean at Oregon. I said, no, I know, and you still didn't get along with the dean. So I said, but you know why it is you're happy here? Because you're a visitor. And you don't have to take responsibility for our sins. You can just stay on the affirmative side of the agenda. You don't have to take the culpability for the sins. So he said, maybe that's right. And I said, okay, so have you ever heard of Walter Alston? Now, tonight I'll teach my course, Baseball is a Road to God. But even though baseball is a road to God, probably most of you don't remember Walter Alston. Walter Alston managed the Dodgers for 20 years on 21-year contracts. Walter Alston would never take more than a year contract. And I said, Derrick, I want you to be the Walter Alston of legal education. I said, we will appoint you as a visitor every year, and we have to hit 20 years. And it's just a great, great thing that this was his 20th year. And he's still here, and he's still here in all of us. This great man who loved students because he loved people and just wanted to make the world a better place, who knew that there was a reward for that coming, and who is waiting for all of us to join him. Right, Janet? Yeah.
Thank you so much, John. I'm now delighted to introduce Patricia Williams, the James Dohr Professor of Law at Columbia Law School, where she's taught for 20 years. She's a former recipient of the MacArthur Fellowship. I once learned when Sylvia Law, another recipient, was introduced, that does not make her a former genius. It makes her still a genius. Prior to joining Columbia's faculty, she served in the faculties of the University of Wisconsin, CUNY, Golden Gate University. She was a fellow at Dartmouth School of Criticism and Theory, as well as the Center for Advanced Study in the behavioral sciences at Stanford. She's published widely about race, gender, and the law, including the critically acclaimed book, The Alchemy of Race and Rights. And she writes a column for The Nation called Diary of a Mad Law Professor. As I'm sure she'll tell you, Professor Williams sat in on Derrick's con law class, both as an undergraduate and then again as a law student, and worked very closely with him as his research assistant. Thank you so much, Patricia, for talking to us today.
Thank you. It's a tremendous pleasure to be here. John said that he thought he would not be here if it hadn't been for Derrick Bell, and I know very, very well I would not have been here if it had not been for Derrick Bell. There is absolutely no question. And to the degree I'm associated with critical race theory, even though my basic subjects are contracts and uniform commercial code, nobody ever associates me with that, because critical race theory is what I think I'm mostly associated with. And it's not a singular philosophy or a unique methodology, and sometimes I think it's used very carelessly to describe anybody who writes about race. But I think I'm a critical race theory scholar because of Derrick Bell. And when you understand Derrick Bell as the core of critical race theory, then you understand why it is so diverse, why to some degree it's hard in legal terms, in methodological terms, in ideological terms, to describe exactly what it is. It's because, as John described, the core of it is Derrick Bell, and Derrick Bell was heart and spirit, and the law probably has no language for that. But let me try to give some sense of why I love being in that interdisciplinary warm embrace of his legacy. At the Association of American Law Schools convention just last month, there was a memorial to him. And it was held in a room that seated maybe close to 500 people. And it was full. And the people there were from everywhere. All of them were law professors, and they were of all races and nationalities. And that event actually rocketed me back to my first AALS meeting back in 1980, when there were virtually no people of color in law teaching at all. And the minority law section was actually, it was a room of maybe seven white men, good, hardworking men who were trying to diversify the profession. But it was a very small group of dedicated men, for again, they were only men in those days, who wanted to hold open the doors. And Derrick was there, of course, and he was working that room for all it was worth. Now, how I came to that room at all by 1980 was because of Derrick, of course. I graduated from law school in 1975, and I have gotten to know since Derrick's passing that there is enormous sibling rivalry among those of us who felt close to him as students and then as profession. I was just shocked at his memorial at how many people stood up and said, "Father Derrick." I said, "No, no, no, that's my father you're talking about." And there was some sort of little tinge of competition that realizes I may have known Derrick longer than John. I met him when I was 19 as an undergraduate. A friend of mine dragged me to his constitutional law class, and it was sort of like flypaper. Anybody who came within Derrick's reach suddenly became a law student and then a lawyer, and sooner or later they were probably destined to become a law professor, whether they liked it or enjoyed it or not. So when I graduated from law school in 1975, it was about the same time as The Paper Chase came out, which highlighted the harsh questioning of the Socratic method that then reigned supreme in most of legal academia. And I cowered with my classmates in fear of what often felt like mockery or derision. And in addition, of course, as I said, there were virtually no women in those days. We were only 8% of the class. I was not called on by Arthur Miller in class, because he still was practicing Ladies' Day, actually, in those days. And so they would call on women one day a month and sort of give them the powder puff questions. We actually had a term for it, the powder puff questions. And sexism was only beginning to be addressed as just possibly inimical to the educational process. And I should apologize for that, because actually Arthur Miller turned out to be, I mean, those were the times. He was a great teacher, actually. And I had expected to love law school with all my heart when I came, and instead I really wanted to leave within the first 10 minutes. And Derrick was the only reason I didn't leave. And as he had in my very first class, with him, he made ideas come alive. He made the dry pages of treatises vivid. He never let us forget the human stories behind every tract, every suit, every appeal. He imbued legal education with a sense of purpose and responsibility. And we weren't there for ourselves alone, but to live up to a calling and to be of service. And he helped me reframe the sense of isolation and intimidation I felt as causes as precisely the reasons there was an obligation to stay the course. And until Professor Bell, people like me, females, African Americans, students who weren't wealthy, who weren't legacies, were pretty much left to our own devices to try to penetrate the old boys' network. We had to discover that secret societies even existed before we could try to break down the doors. And we had to comprehend how many deals were made in eating clubs before we could understand why invitations to those high tables was not merely about the potatoes au gratin. There was every manner of institutional insularity in those days, calculated to shut out most of the world. And in contrast, Professor Bell's door was always open. His mind was always open. He made others' doors open, too. He supported disability, elderly, gay rights, long before any of that was part of the national conversation. He worked to get more women on the faculty when few others thought their lack an issue. And over time, his efforts changed the way all law schools treated students. And he spoke truth to power in a way that removed that notion from mere cliché. And he created family in the unlikely setting of a law school. And Derrick connected me and so many of us to a practice of being. And a few years after I graduated from law school, Professor Bell urged me to think about teaching. And again, this was not the career path I would ever have considered otherwise. And this was at a time when there were virtually no women in law teaching, to say nothing of women of color. To be precise, there were six of us in the entire United States. And I believe Paulette Caldwell was one of them. And there were four African-American women, one Asian-American woman, and one Latina. And that includes the historically black colleges. Derrick said that he just saw me as teaching, and so it was. It would be too easy to say he was visionary like that, but the truth is he made things happen. In my case, he dragged me kicking and screaming. And he believed in a broadly inclusive mandate for equality that was boundless and prescient, and he pushed and he pulled and he checked in on his students and he made friends with them for life. He was a mentor before we had a word for that. And in not just mentoring us, but pushing us into places we didn't even see for ourselves, he brought a diversity of voices to the profession, unorthodox, interesting voices of many pitches, keys, beliefs, and styles. And critical race theory thus began with his urging. And so, in January of 2012, the room at AALS was packed to the rafters. In January of 2012, that room was integrated, and integrated not just with blacks and whites and men and women, but with Haitians and Japanese Americans and Jamaican Americans, Trinidadian Americans, Native Americans, Chicanos, Cuban Americans, gay Americans, Jewish and Muslim Americans, and I think probably some Jewish Muslim Americans, and just a host of viewpoint Americans and multiple identity Americans, and they were all law professors. It was a remarkable sight, and still, I could hear Derrick's voice inside me saying, "And we can do better yet." Professor Bell unsettled by making intimate what was distant. He made strange what we thought we knew, and therefore invited us to explore it more. He played with figures of speech in his writing so that ideas became animated, personified, vivified. He inverted the subjectivity of living agents and danced with objects that otherwise would not have had the legal status of a doorstop. And appreciating this, I thought of it as law jazz. I know he loved gospel, but I thought he made jazz, if one may call it. It did require, I think, a sense of play. The great legal realist Felix Cohen once wrote that when the vivid fictions and metaphors of traditional jurisprudence are thought of as reasons for decisions, rather than poetical or mnemonic devices for formulating decisions reached on other grounds, then the author as well as the reader of the opinion or argument is apt to forget the social forces which mold the law and the social ideals by which the law is to be judged. I think Derrick went even further than just observing that poetics exist in legal discourse. He actually created a counter-poetical fictional world to bring home the point. And so when Derrick Bell wrote his parable some years ago entitled The Space Traders, one of my favorites, in which the United States trades its entire population of African Americans in exchange for an extensive cache of gold proffered by some visiting space aliens. It was an obvious allegory for Bell's pessimism about the promises of the civil rights movement and his fear that too many citizens just want the problem of inequality to be magically whisked into the clouds and disappear. Yet it was startling to see how many in the Legal Academy did not see it as that kind of allegory, but raged in some quarters about the stories being, quote, untestable. And there's actually on YouTube, I found recently, an actual law professor, whom I will not name, at a school I will not point out, accusing Derrick Bell of being untestable, or the story of the space trader story being, quote, untestable. And then following it up with a denouncement of it as an unanalytical fantasism or mere storytelling. Now, again, I think it helps to have a sense of the ludic in all of this. But one reason I loved The Space Traders, despite its pessimistic bottom line, was that Bell used the device of science fiction to throw a great big monkey wrench into the inner workings of what Felix Cohen called the dialectic hydraulic interpretation press, which could press an indefinite number of meanings out of any text or statute. And so, untestable, well, duh. Honestly, how humorless do you have to be to lob a complaint like that? And so when Bell and all of us so-called critical race theorists who followed in his wayward path tinker with fictive devices and poetic figurations, he and we do so for very specific non-imaginary ends. And the purpose is to make the dry pages of treatises vivid, to push the claims of the disenfranchised into the spotlight as he did so well, to burn memory into hearts and minds, to give flesh to the unseen, and to rattle the bones in the closets of history, to be of service by any means necessary, as Derrick Bell always was. For Derrick Bell touched more people than most of us mere mortals could ever dream. He was a great man precisely because there were no conditions upon his energies. He had a huge capacity for love, for justice, and for justice as a form of love. Like all the greatest teachers, his influence remains eternally generative.
Thank you so much. I'm pleased to now welcome Gabrielle Prisco. Welcome her back to the law school. Gabrielle is an alumna of the law school. She was an Arthur Garfield Hayes Civil Liberties Fellow while she was here. And she later returned as a Derrick Bell Fellow, where she worked alongside Derrick to teach this super complicated course in constitutional law and engage in scholarship on race and racism in American law. Gabrielle is now the director of the Correctional Association of New York's Juvenile Justice Project, which advocates for community-based crime prevention and alternatives to incarceration for juvenile defendants. Previously, she worked at the Legal Aid Society as a juvenile rights practice attorney and served as a William J. Brennan Fellow in the American Civil Liberties Union National Legal Department. Welcome back, Gabrielle.
Thank you to President Sexton, to Dean Revez, to the annual survey. I'm really struck by Ben and the other students on the journal. I remember being in law school and barely having time to sleep, let alone to take care of the intricate details for a day like today. So many thanks. And it is also an honor to always be with Janet and to speak on a panel with Professors Dorsen and Williams. In October of 2003, Ken Bain, who was then director of the NYU Center for Teaching Excellence, wrote a letter to Professor Bell about what he observed during his time interacting with Professor Bell's class. Mr. Bain wrote, "Dear Professor Bell, I write to provide feedback on your class in constitutional law. As you know, I have had an opportunity to observe your class several times, to review all of the available printed material for the class, to observe the products of student work, and to talk with some of your students about learning in the class. On that basis, I offer the following feedback. I must tell you that working with your class has been a marvelous experience because it comes closer to the ideal learning environment described in the research literature than does any other class I have observed at this university. Your class contains a number of elements that are well supported by the research literature on university learning and teaching, and that most likely account for the high level and deep nature of the learning that is taking place in the class. Mr. Bain went on to describe what he saw as the several key ingredients to the successful learning environment Derrick created in his classroom. The first was that, in Mr. Bain's words, you have given students a strong sense of control over their own education, and you have done so with both large and small elements of the class. In my own words, it went like this. When I arrived here at NYU Law, I anticipated a deep engagement with critical issues, legal issues, intellectual issues. Law school was for me, as it is for many students, many of us come here seeking the desire to be part of the quest for social justice, to use the law as a way to think about how society can be better, how it can be fairer. I had many smart and hardworking professors and classmates, but I was quickly disappointed by how little space there was, how little intentional space there was for critical engagement of the law and issues of social justice, particularly in the first year curriculum. So I met Derrick Bell because I got found out. I was crying in the bathroom of this building upstairs. And this is, you know, John spoke about sort of the stories we all have. This is my story. So I was crying because I didn't want to be here. And I didn't feel that my spirit and myself, my brain, the way I thought, had a place in this school. And I wasn't really sure what to do about it. And it's very expensive. So a teaching assistant from my civics procedure class accidentally came upon me sobbing in the bathroom. And the class that she was the teaching assistant for was taught by John Sexton, who was then dean of the school. And she, without telling me, spoke to him. And I later got a call from Dean Sexton's office saying that I was requested at his office for an appointment. So I showed up. I remember what I was wearing. I remember being totally terrified. And I told John, I'm sure he was kind and gracious. He definitely gave me a hug and, you know, was very kind and said, sort of, tell me what's going on. And I said that I didn't believe that the environment was a positive one. Actually, when I was writing this, I struggled with, I should say what I really said, which is I said that I thought it was pathological. And I decided I was not going to say it. And now that I'm here, I should be honest, that's what I said. I said I thought it was pathological and that I asked him if I could get my tuition back if I left. It was the first semester of my first year. And Dean Sexton was as gracious and kind and thoughtful, and he spoke to me about his experiences at Harvard. He didn't tell me about the option of taking your classes from, you know, home and taking the tests at a hotel. I might have signed up for that, but he was wonderful. And this is what he ultimately said. He said, I want you to meet someone. And in walked Janet and Derrick Bell. And I said, I've signed this form. I've asked for Derrick Bell to be my mentor. I know he's really busy. I know he's really famous. I know his work, and John said, well, I want you to meet him. And Janet and Derrick were, as they always are, gracious and graceful. And there are stories that you tell time and time again, and they take on kind of a mythological or maybe a magical proportion. And the story for me is one of those stories. It's like a totem, right? This is a story of how I came to be here and how I found my home and my place here. And it's a story that grounds me in the work that I do now. And I wonder sometimes, like, does the magic come from the retelling, or are those stories magical? And so do they push you to tell them and to keep telling them? And the more you tell them, their power grows, right? And this is a story for me. Derrick was magical for me. And so what Derrick did is he invited me to sit on one of his con law classes. And later he invited me to one of the dinners with the spreadsheet. I probably wasn't on, I was like the added guest, so I might not have been on the spreadsheet about how much it would cost, but I was allowed to eat and maybe even get an appetizer. And so Derrick's class relied on students teaching one another. That's how it worked. There was a series of hypothetical, and if anyone wants the long explanation, myself and many of the former Bell Fellows and students and TAs in the room will I'm sure, even reenact for you how the class went, but students teach one another the materials, and Derrick facilitated a conversation and an engagement, but he didn't lecture. And then he would take the students out for dinner who had presented that day's work, and would continue the conversation and the debate and the analysis at dinner at Ennio and Michael's, a restaurant that later, when it was closed, or when it closed, Derrick took up the cause of trying to keep the restaurant open as well. And I got involved in that, as did my family and many loved ones, because Derrick made you do that, right? So, but in that class, I saw that a different way was possible. So Derrick's teaching and his spirit that first year, just being in the classroom, were like beacons. I saw that I could engage the law in a way that resonated with my soul. And this was another place when I was writing where I paused and I thought, soul, that's kind of a funny word to write speaking in a law school. Can I write that? And this was like my brain going, can I write that? I'll delete it. I deleted it. Then I put it back. I said, I'm going to write it. That's the right word. The word is soul. And I thought about it and I thought, can you say soul in a speech in a law school that will maybe wind up in a law journal? And I said, well, if you're writing about Derrick Bell, I think you have to say the word soul. Because soul, Derrick was a gentle soul and a fierce soul. He was a fierce, gentle warrior, a humble warrior, and he was defined by his soul, and he spoke to our souls, and he speaks to our souls today. And he guides our souls as well as our minds and our hearts and our voices, and he helps us see the way those things are interconnected. Right? That's what gospel choirs, that's what the concert about. It's not about music getting your brain to do something. It's about the interconnection between our souls and our hearts and our voices and our brains and our spirits and each other. And so the second thing that Ken Bain said in his letter is that you, Derrick Bell, have created a collaborative environment in which the students are more likely to learn from each other. So in a con law midterm evaluation, one of Professor Bell's students wrote about this themselves. They hadn't read Ken Bain's letter because Derrick did put it in a memo to Ricky, but he didn't, or then John, but he didn't actually tell all his students, I'm an excellent teacher and have been called the best teacher, you know, ever. He just did his thing, right? But the student wrote the same exact thing. This is what the student said. I was a Bell Fellow at this time, so I had the evaluations. He said, I think that this class represents one of the highlights of my legal education at NYU. The diversity of voices in the classroom brings a clarity and reality to discussions which is often lacking in other classes. I have learned an immeasurable amount from students representing otherwise marginalized perspectives. I truly think that this class has enabled me to engage with the material and legal precedent on a much more critical level, demonstrating the structural inequalities of our system, end quote. So here's another story that's persisted in my memory. When I was a first-year student here, I organized a panel on voice and silence in the law school classroom. Professor Caldwell, others were there. We focused on the voices of women and the voices, what gets heard and what doesn't get heard in the law school classroom. And it was actually fairly upsetting for me to hear Professor Williams speak today. Not she was beautiful and touching, but because some of what she was speaking about, I experienced many, many years later, when you would think that more would have changed, but it hadn't, right? So I publicized and others publicized this event, and I got an outpouring of email in response. Many women emailed me and said that they had made a decision not to speak in class anymore. Some talked about the point at which they decided to silence themselves, and that's actually how they spoke about it. This is the point at which I decided to stop speaking. Other students emailed me to tell me why the panel was not needed. One student in my section wrote that he and two classmates had been using a timer in our classes, and they reported on the amount of minutes that women spoke in each class versus men, and they were happy to report that women had spoken on an average of X amount of minutes more than men in our classroom. I was wondering if like maybe I was like 9 of those 10 minutes, but I didn't say that. So they, you know, said this is not necessary. We did the timed experiment during a, you know, sampling of classes. They also said, another student wrote, that the existence of a large number of women on the bench, including the federal bench, make clear that issues of sexism are obsolete. So that was one experience. And then I got to Derrick's class as a student, a TA, later as a Bell Fellow. And the bitter impact of that experience was lessened, and I found and claimed more of my own voice. And I learned how to ground my thoughts on justice and on fairness, also in the framework of the Constitution and in legal thinking. And I learned that from Derrick, but I also learned it from my colleagues in the classroom. So the third thing that Mr. Bain said, don't worry, there's not that many, was that you have helped students learn by getting them involved in trying to solve problems, constitutional issues that they have come to regard as important. So another student in that 2004 class, again, without knowing it, illustrated this concept by saying, linking con law to the politically charged issues of our day forces us to think about the consequences of our legal reasoning. You show us who will suffer from our decisions. No longer can we pretend that we cannot see the world from our ivory towers. And Derrick reminds us, and I'm going to use the word in the present tense, he reminds us that the work we do in the world matters, that we are the problem solvers of this time and place. We are the problem solvers of this time and place, and that much rests in our hands and in what we do with that. So one of the most recent memorials for Derrick, Lisa Marie Boykin showed a film that interspersed that she'd made interviews with Derrick with historical footage and recollections of people who knew and loved him. And there's this one scene that has really haunted me. There's a very frightening and brutal photo of police officers, and they're unleashing attack dogs. They seem to be German shepherds. They have barred teeth on civil rights protesters. And a voice off screen asked Derrick, who was recalling his school desegregation work in the Deep South, weren't you afraid? And Derrick, and I want you to take a minute if you can think of Derrick's voice, right? His soft, gentle, humble voice. And just think about him saying it. He said, well, you just really couldn't think about that. And the fourth thing that Mr. Bain said is you have created an environment in which students believe that their work will be considered fairly and honestly. And the fifth is that you have provided an opportunity for students to try, to come up short, to get feedback on their efforts, and to try again in advance of summative judgments about their efforts. I would add that Derrick was interested and engaged in our lives, our interests, our passions, and our loves. He often encouraged us to think about finding suitable life partners, and he often talked about the joys of marriage and about his love, Janet. His willingness to allow us to try, to come up short, to course correct, to try again, extended beyond the classroom and into our growing up. Derrick often spoke about, as Professor Williams said, his students as adopted children and grandchildren, and he embodied one of the most amazing and essential aspects of parenthood and grandparenthood, which is unconditional love and a willingness to allow your children to make mistakes, to change, to grow, to mature, to course correct. And Derrick allowed us to do that, and he encouraged us to do that. And finally, Derrick reminds us that the fight for social justice, the fight that he was so engaged in, is a fight best fought not only with intellect, reason, and determination, but with love and song and food and even joy. And he reminds us to take care of ourselves. I recently was reading an email he sent me. I told him I'd gotten an interview for a job I wanted. It's the job I now have. And he was a reference. And I said, you should expect to call. And he and Janet wrote back, said, quote, as your adopted parents, we want you to do good when you get the job, but not kill your damn self. And that is serious, end quote. So at the very end of participatory learning, a detailed exposition, which is one of the detailed expositions of his method that he had written for the law school to explain his course, this is what Derrick wrote, and I'm going to end here. When asked about retirement, I respond that, health permitting, I intend to keep teaching until I get it right. In setting up my permanent visitor scheme back in 1992, then law school dean John Sexton dubbed me the Walter Alston of legal academe. Alston managed the Brooklyn and Los Angeles Dodgers baseball team for 20 years on a string of one-year contracts, equaling the Alston record would mean not only that I survived to age 82, but that I have done so doing work that I love and I hope serves some worthwhile purpose. As many of you know, Derrick died shortly before his 81st birthday. While he may not have equaled the Alston record in years or made 82, there is no doubt that his work and his life served a deeply worthwhile purpose. And there's no doubt that he got it right. And there is also no doubt that all he taught, guides us, me and each of us, towards lives of meaning and worth. Thank you.
Thank you, Gabrielle. Our last speaker is my colleague and someone who worked closely with Derrick for a long time, Norman Dorsen, the Frederick and Grace Stokes Professor of Law here at the law school. Norman is the founder and co-director of the Arthur Garfield Hayes Civil Liberties Program, and he also serves as a counselor to the president of New York University, to John. Norman has taught at NYU for over 50 years. He is in his sixth decade of teaching at the law school. And he has seen our institution through times of incredible positive change, many of which he spearheaded himself. For many years, Norman was president of the American Civil Liberties Union. Among many honors, he was awarded the Eleanor Roosevelt Medal for contributions to human rights in 2000. He was the annual survey honoree in 2001, and received the Association of American Law School's first triennial award for lifetime contributions to the law and to legal education in 2007. Norman was the founding faculty director, not only of the Hayes Program, but also the Hauser Global Law School Program. And in that connection, he launched the now very influential International Journal of Constitutional Law. Thank you, Norman.
Thank you very much, Ricky. Now, you just heard from Gabrielle Prisco. Ricky mentioned in passing that she was a Hayes Civil Liberties Fellow, which she was in 2002-2003, in which I am a director, as Sylvia Law is and Helen Hirschkopf is. You can imagine how vital a force that Gabrielle was in the Hayes program. I'm very happy to say that I was able to channel a lot of her energy and a lot of her ideas into improving the Hayes program, because I know that if I didn't do that, she would have made us pay for it and correctly pay for it. I'm very proud of Gabrielle's achievements. She also used the word soul many times, and by doing that, the one thing that is certain is that she has made John Sexton feel very, very good. Because John Sexton has said many times that one of his main missions in life, indeed he may have said the main mission of life, is to save my soul. And with Gabrielle's support, it is still possible. Now, Patricia Williams testified in an imaginative way about the sibling rivalry that is found with regard to Derrick. I hope this is not an example of sibling rivalry, but I will say that I entered Harvard Law School in the fall of 1950, the first class that had women at Harvard Law School. I don't claim to have had special insight at the time, and certainly not special virtue. But it is obvious in retrospect that what Pat was saying and what Gabrielle was saying from a more recent perspective was true, and that women were hardly noticed. There were just about 13 or 14 out of a class of 500. And in all candor, even though there had been African Americans as eminent as Judge Hastie at Harvard Law School in the 1930s, African Americans were even more marginalized. There were fewer African Americans, and they were not given, in my opinion, the respect or attention that they deserved. I want to be very clear that I did not feel that way at the time. I was no better than anybody else, and I didn't understand what was happening, not just in right before my eyes, but historically. Now, once again, to show a possible sibling rivalry, I first interacted with Derrick in the late 1960s when he was a staff lawyer at the Legal Defense Fund. I had come to NYU to head the Arthur Garfield Hayes Civil Liberties Program. And Derrick and I worked together on one or two matters. But the incident that fixed my sense of Derrick occurred after he left LDF to become the first African-American professor at Harvard Law School. It was 1971, and President Richard Nixon had already made four appointments to the Supreme Court, permanently ending the liberal majority in which so many of us rejoiced during the Warren years, and which I suspect we naively thought would be a permanent condition. But we lived and learned, and the civil rights community had to adjust to the new reality. One pressing need was to develop vigorous and sophisticated litigators to work with the lawyers at the ACLU, LDF, the NAACP, and other frontline organizations. A promising source of talent was the increasing number of young activist law professors who were reared on the milk of the Warren Court, and some of whom were already in the struggle. R.E.A. Nair, then executive director of the ACLU, proposed to me the idea of creating an organization of law professors that would be at the center of this effort. I invited about 10 liberal academics to discuss the idea, and it was received with enthusiasm. We expanded the group, and with the aid of Stephen Gillers, then in private practice, and our first executive director, also a former Hayes Fellow, we drafted bylaws and solicited every law school in the country. Hundreds joined. Thus was born the Society of American Law Teachers, known as SALT. An interim board of governors elected me president, and it also selected four vice presidents. The board chose as vice presidents Anthony Amsterdam, then at Stanford Law School and now an NYU colleague, Gary Bellow of Harvard Law School, and Tom Emerson and Ralph Brown of Yale Law School. All were civil liberties stalwarts, and I was not the only board member who noticed that we did not have a person of color in the group, even though much of SALT's agenda was interwoven with racial issues. There were few African American or other minority law teachers at the time. Derrick was junior, having only recently become an academic, but several of us knew of his excellent work at LDF. We elected him a vice president, and I telephoned him to extend the invitation. Derrick did not accept at once. He wanted to know more about SALT, what the organization would do, and what he would do. Moreover, as a new law professor, he was busy learning the craft, as we all had to, and he had special responsibilities, about which more below. We discussed all this. Happily, he called a few days later, saying that however busy he was, SALT's goals reflected his values, and he would be proud to serve as vice president. Moreover, he said, his wife told him to accept. That is a fact. I might add that even with as progressive a group as the Society of American Law Teachers in 1971, we did not, to the best of my recollection, discuss the possibility of appointing a woman vice president, or, as John would say, God forbid, a gay person. SALT has evolved to a wholly different level, discussed, as Pat has discussed, about legal education in general, and is now one of the most diversified groups that I know of anywhere. Several things struck me about my conversations with Derrick. His sole concern was what he might do to help civil rights and civil liberties while fulfilling his duties at Harvard. There wasn't a whisper of what it would mean for his career to be associated with the luminaries already selected as vice presidents, nor was there the slightest suggestion that we approached him laterally after the four white vice presidents were chosen, an issue which he disparaged, saying that, of course, there were only a few black law professors. Further, the questions he asked me about SALT and its newly created mission were probing and imaginative. He raised issues that 20 law professors over four or five meetings had overlooked. All this made us more eager for Derrick to join us. Derrick not only advised SALT wisely over the years, but he emerged as a superb scholar and admired teacher, as you have heard. Among many other things, he wrote the leading law review article on an important and vexing issue. How should lawyers at LDF, the ACLU, and other such organizations serve two masters? The policy goals of the organization they work for and the best interests of the individual clients, goals which sometimes conflicted. I was bowled over when I read the article by how accurately Derrick described the tensions and offered possible solutions that were intellectually and institutionally valuable on a subject that had hardly been explored previously. His even more lasting contribution will be his remarkably creative dialogues or fables that presented past and current issues facing people of color and clarified the moral dilemmas of men and women during centuries of racial discrimination and struggle. It is impossible to read these essays without acquiring a deeper understanding and empathy. But all was not quiet at home base. Derrick had begun to speak publicly on the inadequate representation of African Americans and other racial minorities on law faculties, including his own, Harvard. Many of Derrick's colleagues, I assume in good faith, responded by saying that X or Y did not meet its academic or intellectual standards. While that may have been true in many cases, it was also true about many white candidates, and what counted ultimately were matters of judgment, the feeling of necessity, and the willingness to take some risks, as are routinely done with many faculty appointments. Derrick left Harvard amidst controversy. He continued his stellar career at Stanford and at Oregon Law School, the latter as dean. In both places, he took similar aggressive stances on the need for law schools to expand their hiring horizons. In both places, he created controversy. He couldn't help it. He knew himself, and he knew where he stood. As someone said at Derrick's memorial service, he was born a grown-up. He returned to Harvard, but once again departed, this time to NYU, as you have heard, where he meant so much to our law school over two decades. In time, he took the Vanderbilt Hall law office right next to mine, and we soon deepened our relationship. I was often reminded of the Derrick Bell of 1971. Soft-spoken, modest, and committed. He listened as well as he spoke, as I hope I did. At Derrick's memorial at the Riverside Church, the most striking compliments were from former students at NYU, such as Gabrielle, and other places where he had taught. In his position, he felt a special urgency about monitoring African Americans and other students who were making a way through the maze of legal education. These students almost often came from families that had not previously had a member who attended college. He considered his relations with students to be a deeply important responsibility and opportunity. There was remarkable love for Derrick from those who spoke at the memorial, which did not surprise me one bit as I thought back over the decades to our earliest encounters. Thank you.
Thank you, Norman. So thank you to each of our wonderful speakers for bringing Derrick alive to us. And these stories are great ones. They should be retold often. I have the sense they'll be retold many times in this room and across the hall and elsewhere in the law school, because Derrick is such an important part of our institution and who we are. He'd be deeply missed, but the whole legal community, and ours in particular, will be forever shaped by his legacy. Please join me in thanking the editors of the annual survey for making this great choice, for honoring Derrick in this very meaningful way, and for making the ceremony possible. And I hope you can stay. We'll have refreshments and conversation in that side of the room. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, first of all, thank you again to all of the wonderful dedicators and for your wonderful tributes. And I'd also like to ask you all to join me in thanking and welcoming Janet Duard Bell as we formally dedicate the 69th volume of the annual survey to Professor Derrick Bell.
Thank you very, very much. Derrick would be so pleased. I have to say a couple of quick things. One is that he picked all the speakers because this was planned, started about a year ago, and he would be so pleased with the fact that they were able to speak today. And so many former students, you can be presidents of universities, you can be head of Fortune 500 companies, but in Derrick's mind, you are always a student because he loves students. And so just want to say thank you to the speakers, thank you to Dean Revesz, thank you to President John Sexton, and on behalf of the Bell family, we really do appreciate the fact that people not only keep in mind his memory, but really carry on his legacy, and that's very important. Love, soul, are things that we can talk about in this university and in this law school, and for me, they are represented and they're embodied by John Sexton. Everybody knows we love John Sexton, and when Derrick died, there was no other choice but to have John Sexton do the eulogy, and so thank you again for that. I'm wearing my special edition NYU scarf, because we bleed NYU colors at the Bell household, and John is right that Derrick actually proclaimed that he was happy being at this university. People talk about Derrick and his legacy, and one thing about his civil rights work, he was the lawyer for Medgar Evers' children, and he was there with Medgar Evers just 2 weeks before Medgar Evers was assassinated. So the work that he did was dangerous work, but he never talked about it. He never complained about it. He always said that the people who were there were the ones who were heroic and courageous, because he could always get on a plane and leave, which he did. So his respect for people and his love for people was extended to everybody he worked for, even those people he protested against sometimes. A couple names, you've heard a lot of names here today, but I would be remiss if I didn't really mention two people who were with Derrick, as with many of the people in the room, right up to the very end, and that was his longtime and loving secretary, administrative assistant, whatever the title's called, Gail Thomas, and his fellow, Joy Radice, over there. They made the last year, what became the last semester, just so wonderful. Derrick was never more happy until he came back to the school in that wheelchair when we saw you that day. That was one of the happiest days that I've ever seen, because he was coming back
to an institution he was happy with, coming back to the students that he loved. The week before he died, we were talking to someone at and she said, "Well, what will you miss most?" And Derrick looked at her and he said, in his nice, quiet, sweet way, without hesitation, he said, "I'll miss when I die. I will miss my family, and I will miss my students." Students were always very, very special to him. So I want to thank Ben Wolfert, who was a wonderful example of a student, and the students on the annual survey. Thank you so much for this great honor for Derrick. And I also want to say, Derrick was a person of joy. So all right with the long faces here, all right, okay? We are celebrating. We're celebrating a wonderful life. So I want to leave you with these words that Derrick, besides being brilliant and courageous and all the things you've heard, was really a person who loved to dance and sing and joke and tease, and who really carried joy with him wherever he went. And he wants other people to do that in spite of the struggle. The struggle will continue, but we can still do, as Gloria Steinem said at the memorial service, the electric slide protest while we're struggling for the rights. So just remember the scholarship, yes, but the joy and the purpose and the life of meaning and worth. Thank you so very much.
Well, thank you so much, Janet. And reception it is. Enjoy.